faculty development program on sensor data analytics at IIIT Kottayam. So today we have Dr. Shanti Tilakam conducting the session on sensor data analytics acquisition and monitoring. Okay, so madam is already here, and about her, she's received the BE degree in computer science and engineering in 1991 and MA in computer science and engineering from College of Engineering Guindy and University Chennai, India in 1999, and she had done her PhD in computer science and engineering from NIT Suratkal in 2008. She had been with the department of CSE at NITK since 1996. Okay. So her research interests focus on database security, database data management, data analysis, and distributed computing. She has published more than 60 scientific publications in these fields, including journals, conferences, and book chapters with peer review. She has been the principal investigator for many R&D projects worth rupees 4 crore. She has been involved in the supervision of 14 research scholars. So in 2009, she was a recipient of the Board of IT Education Standard, the best PhD thesis award in computer science and engineering category in 2015. And she also received M.S. Ramanujan Lecture Presenter Award from the Institution of Engineers India. She recently was honored with the Distinguished Alumnus Award from NITK in 2019. She also headed the CSC department from 2019 to 2012, then 2017 to 2019, and held various institutional level positions. She has served as a member of several scientific committees, the board of studies of various universities, and editorial boards. So she has organized many conferences, chaired several technical sessions, and gave tutorials at several international conferences. So for this session, I sincerely welcome madam. So today we have the right person to before us for our participants to enlighten us on sensor data analytics. Okay, thank you, madam. So
thank you so much. First of all, I'd like to thank the organizers for giving me a platform to interact with many other participants across India. Thank you, Anandal. In particular, I wanted to thank Dr. Richard Powell and his persistent effort in bringing right people to this FPP. Thank you, Dr. Victor.
Thank you, sir. Yes.
Unfortunately, I'm down with fever for the past 2 days since I've agreed, so I don't want to deny this. So just anyway, I'll try to do my best today. I'll try to share the screen. So the topic what I've chosen for today's presentation is how the data management happens in the wireless sensor network. Since the workshop is all about the data analytics, so I thought that this will be the off topic. Since I am working in the data management area, I'd like to bring certain issues which may be useful for other researchers who want to concentrate on data management aspects of wireless sensor network. That is the idea behind. So this particular slide you might have seen in all the earlier presenters also. So anyway, I need to give a brief introduction. So that's why I put these one or two slides here. So we need to know the characteristics of the sensor network. We know that sensor network is a highly distributed network, and it consists of very small, lightweight, and low-cost devices. It falls within $1 to $10 generally. And generally, since these sensor networks are normally deployed for monitoring or tracking the environment, so obviously a large number of sensors are going to be placed on ground. So they try to really monitor the environment and try to report the environment's data to the maybe to the sink, or to maybe they may do the processing inside the sensor network itself. So because sensor networks are very, they have very limited resources. So obviously we need to really take the input from the sensor network, and we need to process the data. So that's why we have a base station or a sink, which is going to connect the sensor network to the outside world. And then generally the base station is going to have a very higher computation capability and sufficient power also. So Sometimes, depending upon the applications, we may have more than one sink also to have better the needs of data management. So we know that the organization of a sensor node, because they have a very limited communication capability, and very simple microcontrollers are going to be there. We know that the microcontrollers are going to have both the memory, processor, and I/O associated with that. So it is not a CPU, it is a microcontroller generally. So, and generally the nodes are going to be really supplied with battery power. So generally, because of this radio transceivers, the sensor nodes are going to form a sensor field. And within the sensor field, whichever nodes comes across, they're going to form a network on its own. So that is why we normally call sensor nodes are nothing but the self-organized networks or infrastructureless networks also. So when we consider the sensor nodes, obviously there are a lot of constraints associated with that in comparison with our PDA or other systems also. Very limited power supply, generally 2A batteries are going to be generally used. Nowadays, there are a lot of advancements have taken place. So we are energy harvesting and other type of energy support is going to be provided to the sensor environment, but it is not going to be available for all sort of applications. But still, most of the applications, they rely on the 2A battery. And very simple processes, they don't have enough computing capability to perform any lot of analysis and so on. So we need to depend on the sync node for performing complex activities also. And even they cannot store much data because it's a continuous sensing of the environment. Obviously, we need to have enough memory to store the data. But they're unable to store such data because of its small size and its limited memory capability. And they also have very limited sensing capabilities because the sensor is meant to sense a particular type of environment feature. Maybe. And depending upon how the sensor is associated, okay, they may perform more than one sensing activity, depending upon how the sensor node is organized. And because since these sensor nodes are based on radio transceivers, obviously they have a very limited transmission range within that. So, and as well as they can communicate with the neighboring node with a very low bandwidth, generally this of 250 kbps. This is certain statistics of the sensor node, so we will understand the limitations of the sensor nodes. So the sensor node is deployed to perform certain type of tasks, generally, whichever the applications may be. So they are going to collect the readings from the environment, and as well as not only they perform the sensing operation, apart from that, they are even each sensor node may receive data from other sensors in its network. So in order to do certain kind of a processing and forwarding task to the sync node and so on, there are a lot of other aspects also. So they may receive data from other sensors too, and perform certain kind of computation also on the the data, or maybe they collect the data itself, and as well as they come to transmit the data, whatever they have sensed or whatever they collected from other sensor node to the other set of nodes also. Okay, so generally when they are not active, obviously we'll try to put them into sleep mode also. So that's why we call the sensor node is a distinct information source generally. And the sensor nodes, since they are having a limited memory, they may also store some kind of data histories also, right? So that is for because of the limited amount of memory, they cannot store huge large data histories, but the required information can be stored in the sensor node, because nowadays we have little sophisticated sensors, so the memory capacity is slightly increased nowadays. So we know that the complete the setup and maintenance of the sensor network is going to be completely autonomous, since they don't need to depend on any infrastructure. So that is why they are infrastructureless. As you deploy the sensor nodes, obviously they are going to form a network, and this network is going to be completely distributed way. Since it is a completely or deeply distributed architecture, there is no central control support is going to be available to manage these elements. So we need to really take care of all sort of routing and maintenance algorithms. And as well as since it's considering the distributed nature of the sensor network, we need to take care of all the routing and maintenance algorithms also. Since for any environment, the number of sensor nodes which are going to be deployed to monitor or track the environment, generally it is going to be very large because the tiny devices, low cost devices. So in order to really provide some kind of fault tolerance, we generally deploy huge amount of sensors in a particular regions, okay, so that fault tolerance also can be taken care. So a lot of overlapping kind of information may be there in such environments. So obviously when you deploy huge amount of a large amount of sensor nodes, we cannot focus on address-based routing. We cannot assign IP addresses to each sensor node. So we need to focus on only this data-centric routing kind of a things. Okay. So we know that the sensor networks are infrastructure less, and they're going to form on its own based on their wireless communication capability. So they try to synchronize with each other in a completely distributed manner. And as well as the sensor node also is capable of adapting to the changing connectivity. In case of failure nodes, as I mentioned, that maybe the hardware quality, maybe battery is down, or some other natural disasters, attacks, and intentional destruction due to any other. Suppose we wanted to place new set of nodes to the environment. In all these cases, they are going to adjust by themselves. That is why we normally call it as an autonomous, and they can capable of adapting to the changing environment too. So there are a lot of applications are found, you name anything. So generally these applications can be grouped under two categories generally, either to monitor the environment or to track the environment. We normally use this use the sensor networks. So you're all already familiar, and a lot of other people might have discussed about these applications in specific. So when you consider these wireless sensor network applications, obviously, we know that these wireless sensor nodes are going to produce huge amount of data. And this, since they're going to sense the environment continuously, so the data is going to come in a continuous fashion, that is a streaming way. And as well as the data produced, because I said that in order to really cater the needs of fault tolerating and other aspects, obviously we cannot rely on any sensor node, because sensor node is powered back. Battery backup. So obviously, in case of any failures, we don't want to lose the information from that environment. Obviously, huge amount of sensors are going to be placed. So obviously, the data comes from a lot of overlapping information, or duplicate information may come. So we need to perform certain kind of analysis on the data. So that's why the data produced by these different sensors needs to be compared or matched and analyzed for certain other purposes also. Or we may say that we wanted to extract some specific details from the sensor network. That case also, we need to really get the data from the sensor nodes. So we'll see that what type of queries can be really posed onto the sensor networks, so that how the data is going to be extracted from the wireless sensor networks. Obviously, the behavior of the sensors might need to be adjusted or refined over time also. Suppose I wanted to change the sampling rate, and I want to change the ID of the sensors. So such kind of things also we need to happen, because we need to change the behavior of the sensors also. So in such cases also, we need to do some kind of information passing to the sensor node. And as well as some gathered data is not always known as a priority. Obviously, we need to really focus on all this, because when you consider several applications, when they produce a huge amount of data, we need to take care of all these features. Okay, so that is why the data management is going to play a very important role. And sensor networks usually generate very huge amount of data. So the data management techniques will help us to really create an interface. Suppose I am the user, I want to extract the information from the sensor nodes. Obviously, I need to find the way, easiest way to extract the nodes, because I don't want to be really familiar with what are the sensor network characteristics, how they are connected, what is their bandwidth, whether they are down with the battery. Nothing I wanted to know. As a user, I am interested only in knowing the data which is sensed by these sensor nodes. So the data management techniques will help us provide an interface between the wireless sensor networks and the users in order to extract the data what the user wants. And as well as, because obviously we know that the electrical signals are going to be really converted, the sensed elements are going to be converted in the appropriate format by which the user can easily understand the data which is given by the sensor nodes. So we need to really know that which sensors are going to be contacted to extract the data, and how we are going to present the data to the users are the very important aspects. So whenever the user is interested in extracting the data from the sensor node, I need to find the easy way by which I can be able to extract the data and understand the data which is given by the sensor node. So when we talk about the data management, it is a set of tasks generally. So we need to know that unless otherwise, how the data management can happen, we need to really have a data first, then only we can be able to manage the data. So we need to have a way by which the data can be collected from the sensors. So either it can be collected to the gateway nodes or sync node, or can have all the sensors data, or the sensors itself can have her data. So we will see that what are the way, different ways by which we can able to collect the data from the sensors, and as well as where we want to store the data in the network. All the data which is sensed by the sensors are going to be sent to the sync node, or the sensor nodes, we are going to make use of the memory which is available in the sensor node to store the data. Okay, and as well as after collecting the data, we need to really, the purpose of collecting the data is to serve the needs of the users. Obviously, we need to efficiently deliver the data to the end users. So the data management, when you consider, obviously, the issues are nothing but we need to, how we are going to collect the data, and how we are going to store, and how we are going to process and analyze the data, which are generated by the LS user nodes. So that is what. So at the same time, the process must be efficient. The process in the sense, the entire process, collection, storing, processing, and analyzing the data must be efficient. So each and every stage, we need to consider the limitations of the sensor network, the limitations of the sensor node, and the characteristics of the wireless sensor network. So considering that, we need to really take care of how we are going to reduce the bandwidth consumption. Obviously, we cannot send all the data which is sensed by the sensor node to the sync node. So it's going to consume huge amount of bandwidth. All of you know that when it consumes huge amount of bandwidth, obviously, lifetime of the network is going to go low. And there should not be any delay in accessing the data, because I want the data at this particular instant of time. It should not send the data after that particular instant of time. So there should not be any latency in accessing the data. And the third important aspect is whatever the process you wanted to do, data management task you wanted to do, you need to consider the battery power is very limited. So we cannot really make the sensor to do sophisticated computation, and as well as huge amount of data which is going to communicate to the other nodes also. So these are the different aspects we need to concentrate when we wanted to really consider the data management. Okay, and when we talk about data management challenges, there are two different issues we need to consider. One is we need to consider the different characteristics of the network, another one is the data characteristics. So we know that wireless sensor network is highly unstable and reliable because they depend upon the wireless communicator. So when we say that they are wirelessly communicated, obviously huge amount of network failures, a huge amount of network failures, link failures, high retransmission rates are needed in case of that, high packet missing rates may be there because of that. So we need to take care of this particular issue when we really handle the data management issues also. Another one is a limited power supply. So because obviously we need not communicate too much information to the sync or to the neighboring nodes, because the communication is going to cost much compared to the computing cost. So obviously, so that is another. So by considering the limited power supply, you need to really take care of the data management issues accordingly. Another one is the amount of data which is going to be transmitted. It also needs to be taken care, because it's also going to consume huge amount of power of the sensor network. And obviously, we cannot store everything. So we need to really decide that where we wanted to store the sensitive data because of the limited storage capacity. This is a sensor network characteristic. Apart from that, if you consider the data characteristics of the sensor network, it is completely continuously, because it's going to continuously sense the environment, the data is going to be highly streamed, data streamed, and it is going to be highly dynamic. The information what is sensed at this point of time may not be correct, maybe the next instant of time. So it is going to be highly dynamic. So and sensor nodes or data is going to be highly noisy and uncertain, because they are going to be deployed in a very rugged environment. The sensor network is normally deployed to monitor some very rugged environment. So obviously the sensor data is going to be noisy and uncertain. So we need to find a way by which we can able to really differentiate the noisy and uncertain data also. Okay. Only one third of the survey says that only one third of sensors provide the right data. That is what they're saying that. So generally the sensor readings are going to be used to perform certain analysis, which is going to drive certain kind of alarms also. So the right data is very important from the sensor environment. So we need to really careful about whether we have received the right data from the sensor node or it's a noisy data and so on. So that is important. And next is how much processing we are going to perform in the sensor node or within the network, or how much we are going to perform in the base station. So that needs to be decided. Since all the nodes cannot send the information to the sync node, which is going to increase the number of messages as well as increases the amount of data which is going to be communicated from sensor node to base station also. So we need to decide how much processing we are going to perform inside the network and how much we are going to do it at the base station, and what type of processing we are going to perform inside the network and what type of processing we are going to do it at the base station. So that is another important aspect we need to focus upon. Since I said that the data is of streaming nature, obviously the continuous queries is going to be a very important. Suppose I want to continuously monitor that environment for 10 seconds or 10 minutes, so then the queries remain continuously active. So which is going to consume huge amount of power from the sensor nodes also. This is the typical nature of the sensor queries. Okay, so we need to really work upon how we are going to really handle maybe kind of any kind of queries will be, but we need to really perform some kind of network-based query processing and optimization also. As soon as we receive the query from the user in order to extract information from the sensor nodes, obviously we need to decide that how we are going to process the query and how the optimization is going to take place. So that's where a lot of data management systems exclusively designed for rapid sensor networks have come in place. So these query processor and optimizers are going to really decide a good query plan, okay, and which is based on certain other heuristics. They are going to decide a good query plan and they optimize the query. The optimized queries are going to be routed to the sensor network. So that's what. So and as well as when we wanted to route the optimized query to the network, obviously. The data about the current network topology and the status of the network is going to be important. Without this information, they cannot perform any kind of optimization of the queries also. Sometimes there may be a multiple number of queries may be submitted by different users also. So the query processor and optimization needs to take care of that, how efficiently multiple query support and optimization can be performed. So can we find a way by which these queries can be performed in an effective way. So these are the different data characteristics of the wireless sensor network. So when we design any data management solutions, we need to focus on both aspects. And one is wireless sensor network the characteristics and the data characteristics of the
madam, yeah. Madam, sorry for interruption. Like there is a noise, like a consistent noise is there, madam. Like I think now I couldn't able to.
Now it is fine.
No, madam. I think while you're talking, fan. Is there any fan or loose? I mean, connection related things, small like, kind of noise, which is maybe because of some loose connection. It's a consistent noise is there throughout. Like that's why, madam.
Now it is fine. Now it is fine.
I think, madam, we are hearing the noise while you are started. I mean, talking. I guess, like, madam, while you are with mic, maybe.
Okay, and now we just check that whether it is.
Yes, madam. Yes.
So when we consider the data management.
Now fine. Yeah, thank you.
So when you consider the data management issues, so we need to identify what do you mean by data management. What are the queries needs to be answered? So certain issues I've highlighted over here, and we need to know that what is the sensor data and how that sensor data is going to be represented and where to store and process the sensor data and sensor nodes and how to represent the sensor queries, first of all, and what are the different queries that can be posed and how do we distribute the query fragments in response to the queries also and how do we really provide an access to the sensor data and what is the cost of accessing the sensor data. And when the network conditions changes, how these sensor, the query processing is going to accommodate according to the changing network conditions. And in case of site or communication failure, how this query plan is going to be really affected. And as well as we need to really deploy and manage the sensor database system, how we are going to really deploy and how we are going to analyze the sensor data. All these issues are different research issues. So I'll try to address some of them here and try to give an overall view so that if anybody is interested in any of the issue, we can take it up later. Okay, so when we talk about the data management, obviously the first thing comes to our mind is the traditional database systems. So the traditional database systems are completely unsuited for wireless sensor network for a variety of reasons. Okay, because there is no sophisticated system over here to store the data because the network is going to replace the storage and the buffer manager. Each sensor node is going to act as a database basically. And memory is limited and system is going to be highly volatile, continuous data production, insertions are higher than the queries, all of you know that because they are going to only sense the environment and forward the information, the sensed information to the other nodes or to the sink. And we need to perform a real-time processing of the data. Sometimes we need to really perform a continuous queries, that is long-running queries also. And the store, a lot of storage constraints are going to be associated. Because the traditional DBMS systems, it does not encounter all these kind of issues. So that is why we need to have maybe the specialized DBMS system which can able to handle this data management also. Right. So when you talk about the sensor network, how we are going to extract the data, that is a data acquisition aspect. So it is the first, it's a task responsible for efficiently acquiring samples from the sensors in the sensor network. So I'm not getting into the details of sampling and other aspects. So that is not my domain. So I'm not going to focus upon that. So this is only from the data management aspect I wanted to focus here. So when we talk about how you're going to acquire the data from the sensor nodes, it's either it may be a pull-based approach or a push-based approach.
So when I say about the pull-based approach, the base station is going to send a query to a particular set of sensor nodes and try to retrieve the data from those sensor nodes. That is what we call it as a pull-based. Okay, whenever the data is requested, the base station is going to really send the forward the queries to the respective nodes and get the data. In case of push-based approach, the nodes are assigned with certain conditions. Okay, and the push-based approach is the sensor nodes are going to send the data to the base station. That is what the push-based approach is. I see. How the push-based approach is going to work based on what, all those things we'll discuss it later. Okay, because in push-based approach, we need to have a strategy by which when the sensor nodes are going to send the data to the base station is very important. Okay, and data acquisition is one of the biggest challenge in case of energy efficient wireless sensor networks, because considering the dynamic nature of the architecture, because we need to really work upon, because majorly for performing any kind of analysis, we need to have a data, and the way in which we acquire the data from the sensor node is in a very important aspect. Okay, suppose if you don't handle the data acquisition component efficiently, it is going to affect other data management issues also in turn. Okay, so when you consider the data delivery models, generally there are four ways in which the data acquisition normally happens. One is a continuous model. So the sensors, they keep transmitting data at a pre-specified rate, that is, they time and reset, they're going to keep transmitting the data. And periodic model, obviously we know that at periodic time, they're going to send the data. In case of event-driven model, whenever they detect an event, they're going to push the data to the sync node. And observer-driven model, sensors update their data only when the query is received. That is what, it's basically a query-driven model. And the combination of all these three things can coexist in the sensor network. So these are the various means, generally these are the various means are used by the most of the applications. Either continuously they're going to send the data, or based on the event, they're going to push the data. Otherwise, whenever they receive a query, they're going to reply to the particular query. And the combination of all these things also can work. So the first issue in the data management on wireless sensor network is where we are going to store the data, how we are going to store the data. So that is an important aspect. So the very naive approach, what we can say that all the sensor nodes can, using any one of the data delivery model, all the sensor nodes can send the data to the base station. That is a very, 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 very naive approach. And generally it is practicable, it is very much practical only in case of small sensor networks. In large cases, large amount of is going to be generated and a huge amount of nodes are going to be there. So the network lifetime is going to be completely affected. So the centralized approaches that is sending a data, all the data to the sync node is not at all practical. So that's why we normally go for a decentralized sensor database approaches. They call that it is one of the most energy efficient forms of data storage. But the still thing is there are a lot of other issues are going to be associated with this. So what the decentralized sensor database approach does is they're going to view the data sensor, the sensor nodes as a database. So the whole network is going to be viewed as a distributed database. That is what they're going to do. And each sensor node is going to store its own partition data. Okay, so the sensor database may be used to store the sensor data or maybe the runtime information or maybe some of the history of the performance statistics performing tuning and debugging kind of a things also. And maybe they may have the information about routing table and maintenance information and other sort of information also that is for used for performing fine-tuning operations, okay, for maintenance and routing maintenance and routing formation information also may be there in the sensor nodes. So from the data storage point of view, the sensor network is going to be viewed as a data distributed database, because each sensor node is going to have its own database of sensor data. Okay, and these sensor databases are going to be indexed so that we know that what sensor is going to have what kind of a data, whether there may be a temperature sensors, there may be the pressure sensors and so on. So obviously, they're going to serve the queries from the users, okay? So the queries are going to come from the sync node, and using the sync node, I can propagate the queries to the sensor database in order to retrieve the answer. That is the idea behind how the database people are viewing the sensor network as a database. Since I said that the sensor network is going to be viewed as a distributed database system, each sensor node is a database system. So they can able to access, really process, and answer queries also, Okay, but they cannot perform any kind of a global query processing because sensor node, each sensor node is going to have only the only a part of the data what it can able to really sense the environment. So when we wanted to perform a global kind of analysis about the entire sensor network data, obviously somebody has to be there in place really to perform this the global set of processing of the queries. So that is why normally whenever the user is giving any kind of a query to the sync node, the query is going to be fragmented into pieces, and these fragmented queries are going to be really forwarded to the respective sensor node to get the data, and finally maybe the comparison or mapping of information from various sensor nodes are going to be done at the sensor sync node. So generally, we normally use declarative queries. That is, we use a very simple interface to supply the queries to the sensor network. So that's where we, traditional DBMS systems, they use SQL model. So similar way, here also, sensor DBMSs also use a declarative queries model by which we can able to use SQL kind of queries which can be submitted to the sensor network to really extract the data. Okay, there are various database management systems which are running and sensor nodes are available. TinyDB that is developed by UC Berkeley, Cougar, Cornell University, etc., etc. There are a number of things. But when they view the distributed database as a distributed database system, and the main issue over here is the environment is the constrained computing environment. So adopting the existing database technology for in-network processing is a very, very big, very much question mark. That is why a lot of research has gone towards that. This is just kind of view. And then with this particular idea, people have moved on to the research history. So when you talk about the sensor data, every sensor is going to have three types of sensor data. One is its own properties, a sensor data properties, and it's what it is bound to measure the environment. So the measurement and the timestamp. So the meta information of the sensors, maybe the identification of the sensors, the location, type, unit of measures, etc., etc. And sensor meta measurements also, what kind of measurement it is making. So they are going to really record that. And the timestamp of the measurement is going to be recorded. Apart from that, they're going to have other informations regarding the routing path management and other things also. So that is also going to be there. Primarily, they are going to have three important information. This is where we normally, the user is interested in acquiring the information. So rest of the things are used for only forwarding or communication purposes. So the user may be interested in knowing about the meta information of the sensor, or user may be interested in understanding in the information sensed by that particular sensor, or at what time that information is sensed. They may be interested only in these three things. Rest of the things are used for only for maintenance and monitoring communication purposes. Okay. So by considering this kind of a data, so we need to decide that where we wanted to store the data. Whether we wanted to store all the informations about the sensor data, whatever it senses over a period of time, and whether we are going to describe some informations or we are going to compress the informations which we have it in each sensor before forwarding to the next node, and so on. So that is the decision we need to make. So generally, the sensor data, as I said, that the traditional DBMS model is followed, the sensor data is going to be represented in the form of a table, generally, if you consider the relational data model. So entire database, entire sensor network is modeled as a large distributed database system. So the entire sensor network is going to form one single table and a long table. And for each row is going to be constituted by one sensor node. And each column is going to indicate different attributes of that particular device. So that is how they are going to really store or model or represent the data which is coming from each sensor node. So from the sensor, if you look at the sync node, obviously the sync node is going to have the global information about all the sensors represented in the form of single table. And for each instant of time, separate row is going to be created. So that for each instant of time, we will come to know that by processing this particular table, by querying this particular table, we can be able to get all set of information to whatever the user wants. Okay. So generally, when the user query is querying for some unknown attribute which is not stored in this particular table, they are going to return a null value. Okay. So now we have to think that when the data is going to be stored in this particular fashion, is there any other alternative data models? So generally, people are not currently they are not using any other data model. They are using only the relational data model. As per the Cougar or Tiny database and so on, they are all using relational data models for representing the data. So regarding the data storage aspect, where we want to store the data, there are three existing schemes which are available. One is the data can be stored in the external storage, that is at the sink node, or the data can be stored inside the network at each node, that is what we call it as a local storage. Another one is the data center storage. So instead of storing all the each node to store the data, we'll try to assign some location-based or maybe geographical region-based nodes, so which is going to store a particular type of information. That is what we call it as a data center storage. So when you talk about the external storage, obviously sends everything, okay, and transmit everything to the base station. That is the approach we normally. So don't store anything locally. So the advantage is what, since the base station is having high storage capability and the computing capability, and it is having a persistent centralized storage and highly reliable way of storing the information. And when any user wants to process a query, this can be done in a very efficient and fast way. So that's all. But disadvantage is what, every node has to send all the data, whatever it senses, to the base station. So it is going to really incur high amount of communication cost. So that is what, these are all the first generation data collection systems. So nowadays, most of the applications are not using this particular approach. Instead, they are going for the in-network processing approach, right? And when you talk about local storage with the query planning, in this case, we store the data in each node, that is what I've done, store data locally at each node. The query which is coming from the sync node is going to be flooded out to the network. So the query is going to be flooded inside the network. Every node is going to receive the query given by the base station, and whichever sensor node is responsible for answering query, they are only going to send the information to the base station. So it is basically a demand processing. And so in this case, the data is going to be lost because since the data is going to store in each node, and if any node fails, the data is going to be completely lost. And as well as each node has to have some kind of a processing ability, in the sense when the query is flooded inside the sensor network, obviously the sensor network needs to understand what is the query, whether I am responsible enough to send the answer for this particular query. So it has to have this particular processing capability, query processing capability. Okay, so we need to have a tiny database management system on each sensor node. So that is what. And as soon as the query is going to be flooded across the sensor network, which is also is going to incur high overhead because query is going to, we are not targeting the query to the right sensor node. It's the query is going to be flooded across. That is why a high interest. So in this case, this particular approach is suitable only when queries are simple and have limited scope. And as well as only for rare queries, this approach is going to be suitable because only very rarely we are going to issue a query and take the data from the sensor node. Right. Another approach is local storage and distributed indexing. In this case, we are not going to really store the data at each local node. Instead, the nodes are going to be identified based on the geographical region or based on various parameters, the nodes can be identified. They are going to have little much higher capacity. So that the relevant data which are going to be, maybe the temperature readings are going to be stored in one particular geographically closer sensor node which is having higher capacity. Maybe the pressure readings are going to be stored in another node and so on. So whenever the user queries the data, obviously we know that this prior information is going to be available in the sync node. So obviously the query is going to be routed only to the respective sensor node which is having that relevant information in order to fit with the data. So this case, it makes the search efficient and in a case low communication overhead because this is not going to really forward the request to all the sensor nodes because we know that which node has the relevant information. But what the problem over here is, since one node is going to be designated to store a particular type of sensor data, if the particular node fails, obviously the data is going to be lost. Right. So we need to have some kind of a compromising approach among these three. So, and apart from that, this distributed indexing also can come under two ways, one is deterministic and the non-deterministic. In the deterministic cases, the sync node will decide that which particular node is going to have what type of relevant data. So that is going to be known priori. That information is going to be sent to each sensor node. And each sensor node, whenever they sense a temperature reading, they are going to forward to a particular sensor node for storage purposes. If they are sensing a pressure node, they are going to send it to the relevant sensor node, which has higher capacity, which has been really identified to store the pressure readings, and so on. That is known a priori. But in case of non-deterministic storage, it is not so. So it is going to be the storing data blocks on a randomly chosen nodes. So we need to have a mechanism how we are going to randomly choose the nodes in order to store the relevant data. So that is what some people are working on this particular direction also. So generally, most of the applications are going for the deterministic approach, and some people are working on non-deterministic storage also. Because in this particular case, we need to have failure maintenance mechanisms also. So we need to go for an alternative kind of approach. We need to have a continuous monitoring of this particular node, who is responsible for storing the relevant data. And based on that, we need to have an alternative strategy to replace this particular node and so on. There are a lot of other maintenance efforts are going to happen. So that is why they're going for non-deterministic storage, because they randomly can choose a node to replace the relevant content also. So these are some of the storage mechanisms generally used in wireless sensor networks to store the data. Either you can place all the different sensors on sync node, or we can have it in the each node, or we can assign a group of nodes which can hold the relevant sensor data. The next aspect is, once you have the data, obviously we need to access the data. That is what we talked about, query processing. Query processing is all about accessing the data based on the kind of query what you are going to use. Because the query processing is very essential, because which is going to discover a specific patterns from the sensor data. That's what we are interested in. The purpose of placing a sensor node is what? To monitor the environment. So obviously we need to really monitor the environment. So obviously we'll be, by posing some certain queries, we'll try to monitor the environment. So that is why. So the query processing is going to help us in detecting many things, not only unusual events, even for querying the normal setup also, right? We'll discuss what set of queries can be placed on wireless sensor network later. But all this query processing, the main goal of any query processing wireless sensor network is, the goal is nothing but we need to reduce as much energy if possible. So that is what is the very important. Any query processing should be done with less energy consumption, energy cost. So that is what is very important. So whenever the query processor does, generally the traditional query is going to have can be of three types. One is, they can able to really query the sensor, that is the sampling frequency and other aspects of your sensor nodes. And otherwise, what kind of attributes are going to be sampled, that can be queried. And the specific constraints on the returned values for the giving cost can be really obtained. So basically, answering any query is going to completely depend on the availability and accessibility of the data. So when you talk about any query, the query is going to originate with the sync node, obviously. The sync node is going to really process the query, and based on the metadata information which is placed on this sync node, it is going to really make an optimized plan, and this optimized plan is going to be forwarded to the relevant sensor node, and the sensor nodes are going to coordinate in order to execute this particular query based on the query plan, and finally the server is going to get the result. This is how the query processing is going to take place. So in this particular case, without the catalog information or metadata information about the sensor nodes and the network topology, this optimization is not going to be feasible at all. So the system, the database system, needs to really obtain the metadata information about the entire sensor network and its topology also very frequently. Okay. And when you consider the type of queries which normally is going to be really placed on the wireless sensor network, it may be based on the duration. It may be based on the selection predicate, or it may be based on number of sensor type also. One is duration, in the sense it may be one-shot queries or snapshot queries generally. They wanted to know a particular data at a specific moment of time. So it is only the same short time and time is going to be given in the particular query. So this is what we call it as a one-shot queries or snapshot queries. There may be a continuous query. So we wanted to really obtain the data periodically from a particular moment for a definite or indefinite period of time also. Okay, and when we say that definite period of time, it is a limited range query, otherwise it's going to be an unlimited range query also. So these kind of queries also can be normally stored. Apart from that, the queries may be spatial queries or attribute-based queries also. Suppose when I talk about a spatial query, we say that we wanted to obtain the data from a particular region of the network. Okay, so if that is the case, we wanted to extract the information only from the sensors located at that particular region. Such kind of a queries also is going to be, because we wanted to monitor that particular region only. So that's why spatial queries can be issued. And certain times the attribute based queries also, generally they wanted to give a range of attribute value, okay, whichever data which falls within the range of given attribute value or whichever is going to satisfy this attribute value criteria, that data is going to be obtained. That is what we call it, an attribute based query. I'll give some examples for all those types also later. And the third is nothing but the number of sensor data types. It may be one dimensional query, or it may be a multi-dimensional query also. suppose I wanted to really ask for data of one type of sensitive data. That is, suppose I wanted to only measure the temperature readings from a particular region. That is called a one-dimensional. Suppose I wanted to really get the data of two or more types of sensitive data, then we call it a multi-dimensional query, depending upon the type of application. And generally, when you consider the type of queries in wireless sensor networks, some of the examples I've given, in case of correlations among the set of events also can be queried. Suppose we wanted to sound an alarm whenever two sensors within 10 meters of each other simultaneously detect an abnormal temperature. So we wanted to really find out this, because we need to really sound an alarm whenever two sensors within 10 meters of each other simultaneously detect an abnormal temperature. This kind of analysis needs to be performed at the SIMP node. So obviously, we need to have obtained the data from these two sensors within 10 meters of each other simultaneously detect an abnormal temperature. So we need to monitor the environment continuously and try to find out the correlation among the values of these two sensors. And some queries are going to be aggregate queries. Suppose we are interested only in the maximum temperature in that particular region, or minimum temperature in the region, or average temperature in a particular region. Such kind of queries also can be posed. Suppose we wanted to obtain the historical information, okay? Suppose we wanted to find the average rainfall at all sensors for the last 3 months, how we are going to obtain. This is also feasible. So we need to have historical data of the sensor information, either in the SIMP node or in the in-network nodes also. And certain times, obviously, in response to the query results, the actuation queries nodes to do something, because we will make the result of the query to perform certain kind of actions. That is what we call it as an actuation query also. And sometimes we wanted to monitor the health of the network. That is what we call it as a meta query, a health query. Just we wanted to understand the link quality, nodes availability, battery level, lifetime estimation, and so on also. Sometimes we may be interested in spatial temporal queries also. So just we wanted to find out the room temperature in room. There is a specific spatial information. And even we can spatial window queries also can be failed. Yeah. These are the different types of queries. So some examples I've given, so I'll try to share the slides and you can go through this. Some of the examples I've given for each case also, you can go through that. So in order to process these queries, as I said, that SQL-based type of declarative query approach is normally used. So we normally use a relational algebra operators to really to perform the query processing. So obviously we use this kind of predicate, select, project, join, and aggregate operations by which we can be able to specify what the user wants also. So select, in the sense we are interested in only filtering the useful readings, and we know that we wanted to select only these type of values from this kind of a sensors. That is what, whenever which particular sensors are going to satisfy this particular predicate, only such readings are going to be useful. Project, in the sense we are going to project only certain type of fields. Normally it is going to reduce the size of the tuple. Only certain fields are going to be really projected out. Okay, not all the fields of the sensor table is going to be projected. So we can able to project only the okay number of attributes by using the project operation also. And the join operation is when you wanted to relate the data acquired by different nodes and we wanted to relate the historical data. So we need to perform a join operation. We need to perform a join operation on that. So that is a need by which you can able to relate the data acquired by different sensors also. Okay, and the next important issue is aggregation, because not all the sensor data is going to be really sent to the sensor node. So we need to find a way by which we can able to reduce the amount of data which is going to be communicated inside the sensor network. So that is where the aggregation operators are going to be match, min, average, all kind of aggregation operators, sum, etc., etc., can be used to perform the aggregation operation also. Okay, so this is what I've already discussed. So the requirements of sensor query processing is limitations are there, and the data is streaming. streaming data, and we need to really process multiple queries. Okay, so this is what a query processing system we really need to take into account. So when you talk about a query processing approaches, there are two approaches. I said that the first data is extracted. There is a naive approach or a warehousing approach. Every data is going to be sent to the sync node, and the query processing takes place only on the centralized database, that is the sync node. So generally, this particular approach is well suited for answering all kind of historical queries or predefined queries also. Okay, but this has a lot of problems. That is why people are going for inner-depth processing, that is a distributed approach. So we try to store the data inside the network itself by using any one of the storage mechanisms we have seen, and allow the queries to be injected anywhere in the network so that we can able to extract the response to the queries and send back to the sync node or to the user, right? So this has to take care of how we are going to reduce the energy consumption bandwidth usage by replacing more expensive communication operations with relatively cheaper computation operations. We try to perform number of computations before transmitting any data. That is a principle design going for this distributed approach. So by this, we can able to extend the lifetime of the sensor network. So when you talk about why this inductive query processing is more needed and why it is so popular, why it has been practiced by most of the applications. Because we know that communication cost is going to be higher than the processing cost. So, and as well as we need to increase the lifetime of the network. So the amount of data which is going to be communicated from each sensor node to the sync node for processing any query should be reduced at the maximum. So that is the major reasons why we normally go for an in-network query process. So we use the computation capability of the sensor node to perform the computations before transmitting any data. So without processing, we need to transmit all the data to the sync node. Instead, they use the processing capability of the data, try to reduce the amount of data which is going to be transferred to the sync node. That is the principle behind the in-network query processing. Right. So, but the assumption over here is, obviously, the sensor node must have computational capabilities, and obviously, the synchronization issue is going to come. Obviously, we say that, suppose I'm in this particular example, say that I'm dependent on the input data coming from the sensor node. Obviously, I'll wait for the information to come from the sensor node. This is going to create a lot of latency and the synchronization problems also. So most people in idealistic situation, they assume that all the sensor nodes are going to use the same clock and the sensor nodes are going to be synchronized. But in this real scenario, it is not going to be so. And another case is because of unreliable wireless communication, link may be broken. And that is another issue we need to take care of it. And as well as we need to provide a path by which a sensor node is going to send the data to the sync node also. So normally it is done with the help of a routing tree. Okay, so we need to build a routing tree and maintain the routing tree based on the changing topology of this particular network too. So generally in network query processing case, most of the dissemination of the query and collection of the result is only based on the routing tree. So we need to really take care of how the routing trees are going to be really constructed. So all the most of the approaches, whatever I highlighted, OTL, tiny OS, quantity RTL, or light OS, all are using one or the other routing trees to do the routing of queries as well as the collection of results for this particular set of queries also. So when I talk about the routing tree, it is going to view as a query tree, obviously. Which node is going to send the information to which particular node is going to be. So every node is nothing but a central node, and the edges between the nodes are going to represent the routing paths. Okay, that is going to be determined by the existing routing protocols. Because I said that it is not address-centric, it is based on the data-centric route. So by using any kind of existing data-centric routing protocol, we can able to define this particular routing tree. So building an energy-efficient routing tree is very important with respect to queries, because we need to really minimize the total number of messages which are going to be really passed while disseminating the query, as well as collecting the results of that respective query. That is very, very important. And as well as maintenance of this particular energy-efficient routing tree is also another important aspect the researchers need to consider. There are various query processing approaches for are normally existing. One is Cowger approach, Peugeot approach, TAG approach, and tiny database approach, Antelope, and so on. And just I'll give some of them here. So the Cowger approach is one of the oldest approach. They provide SQL type of interface. They also support aggregate queries also. the query optimizer assumes that it has enough information really to plan the query optimization, and which is going to be located at the gateway node. Okay, and most of the sensor data is going to be all stored in the sensors, and they're going to be represented as a time series data also. Okay, and they also assume that, I said that they're all time synchronized. They all assume that this particular approach assumes that all the nodes are having a common platform. Okay, since it is in a sensor node is going to only sense the environment, no update or delete are going to be supported, only insertion operation is going to be permitted. Suppose in a particular environment, suppose we wanted to insert a new node to with the new sensing capabilities, this approach does not support that. So there is a major problem over here. Okay. And as well as this particular approach, it does not suggest, even though data is going to be stored in the local sensors, it does not suggest how long the data is going to be held in the particular node, because we need to have a replacement mechanism, because the sensor capacity is limited. Okay. So every sensor node is going to have certain query processing abilities, and as well as the sync node is going to have some other query processing ability. So the query proxy at the sensor node, which is going to be there to interpret and execute the queries at that particular node, since the node is going to have the data. So obviously they're going to interpret the query and execute the query and forward the query with respect to the routing algorithms, right? And the sync node is going to have the front end, the graphical user interface. So by which the data obtained from this particular node is going to be projected to the user, right? The second approach is the code approach. Here also, the user is going to issue a query to the sync node only. Here, what they're going to do is the server is going to process the query, okay, and it is going to locate the proxies for the sensors that can have a relevant data to you. As I mentioned that in the distributed indexing, we are going to have number of sensor proxies. So these sensor proxies are nothing but a region-based sensor node, which is going to store a specific type of information. That is what they call it as sensor proxies. So suppose if I wanted to post a temperature-related query, obviously the sync node knows that which particular sensor proxy has the temperature-related information. So they're going to really, the optimized queries are going to be forwarded to the sensor proxy to get the information. So that is what this particular approach says. But in this case, the proxies do not participate in any kind of a processing. Okay, they only perform a simple aggregation because the query is rooted there. So they're going to only give the result of that particular query, and they may perform a simple aggregation before leaving that data. And so another approach is the tag approach. The tag approach is aggregation service for ad hoc sensor networks generally. So it is normally done with the help of three functions, one is a merging function, initializer, and an evaluator. So here also the user is going to post a query from the base station. And the messages are also going to propagate from the base station to all the nodes through the routing tree rooted at the base station. The routing tree is going to be constructed. So what they're going to do is they're going to divide the time into epoch period. For each epoch, the sensor route the local and children data back to the user routing. That's all they're going to do is, right? And another approach is called the tiny database approach. Here also, they're going to use a semantic routing tree in order to route the queries to the sensor node. Okay, and using this semantic routing tree, they are going to really disseminate the query, and they are going to extract the results of the query. And each node is also going to maintain a catalog metadata associated with these attributes and events and user-defined predicates. Okay, and each node is also going to periodically send a copy of this metadata so that the sync node can really plan for global optimization of a particular query. And this is a simple approach. Every node is going to have a tiny database query processor inside in order to process these queries. Okay, this is the async node, okay, which is having other GUI and API elements. So as far as I said that whenever we are going to generate an optimized query plan, the information about the optimizer needs to have the information about the complete network. Okay, so that they can able to evaluate about the information about the sensor node as well as the network topology and so on. So based on that only the optimizer can able to really generate the optimization plans, and based on that they can estimate the cost for each generated plans, and based on which they can able to really pick up which is the optimal query plan which is going to be forwarded to the sensor node. All right. So generally, the catalog can be built and maintained on a server, one approach. Another one is the catalog can be maintained at the the local catalog can be maintained at the sensor node, okay, which is going to give the information about sensor position, density, the connectivity, system workflow, network privilege, and so on. Based on this information, they periodically collect the data from the sensor node. They can update the global catalog, which is maintained at the sensor node. Okay, using this information, they can be able to decide to optimize the query plans. Okay. The next important aspect is query. Next important aspect is a query optimization. Suppose I wanted to find the average temperature of the fourth floor sensors. That is what my query is. How the query optimizer is going to plan for it? One is we can collect the readings from every sensor, then filter the list of the fourth floor sensors and compute all. This is one approach. This is also going to result the answer for this particular query. Another way is because there are multiple ways by which the answer for this query can be retrieved. So second way is what? We can only request the data from only the fourth floor sensors, which are providing the temperature readings, and then find the average value of it collects. Obviously, the query optimizer has to take the next plan, the second plan, because the query dissemination is going to be done only to the fourth floor sensors, not to all the sensors. The amount of messages is going to be less, and as plus the data coming from all the sensors is going to be avoided in this particular case also. So any query optimizer generally works out all possible query plans. Okay, maybe a logical query plan, or it may be a physical query plan. Both the cases. Initially, they frame the logical query plan. They try to optimize based on certain heuristics. Then they go for cost-based optimization. Okay, and they're going to associate, that is what we call it as a physical optimization. So the physical plan is going to be generated with associated cost, and then finally the query optimizer is going to decide which is the optimal query plan, which is going to be disseminated inside the network. So that is what is going to be done. So generally, the query optimization cannot be done inside the sensor network. It has to be performed only on the sensor node, the server side. So that is what is important. So obviously, in order to perform a query optimization, the information about the sensor network status is always important. Without that, the query optimizer cannot really generate the plan. So there are various type of optimization based on what we want to optimize. Depending upon that, we can set the parameters also. And most of them are power hour query optimization is done. So they would try to estimate, generally most of the query optimizers which are existing in place, they try to really reduce the energy consumption. Okay, considering all this processing cost, sensing data, transmitting cost, and receiving cost. Based on this, they try to optimize the queries. Okay, and another one is multi-query optimization. Suppose they receive a huge amount of queries to get propagated inside the sensor network. Obviously, how I can give an answer for all these queries is going to be really identified. We can able to identify the common subduplicates among the shared queries. Okay, and we can return the results of the updated queries or updated sensors and so on. So what is the best way, effective way by which the multi-queries can be answered in a better way? So that is what the query optimizer is going to decide in case of multi-query optimization. So the objectives is going to be set depending upon the type of application and the type of environment. These are the various challenges. And in network query processing, when you consider the wireless sensor network, obviously there are queries are of very, very, very diverse. Okay, so the users are interested in posing different types of queries as we discussed earlier. And sensor selection is a very important query requirement, because then only we can route the query to the right sensor. Otherwise, flooding is going to take place or gathering is going to take place. So the query execution plan is a very important aspect. Obviously, we need to have a clear idea about what is the cost is going to be associated with this particular query plan. Okay, with the help of the network status, we can able to really have a right plan so that the query execution plan can be proper, by which we can able to reduce the bandwidth as well as reduce the amount of messages which is going to be transmitted also. Okay, and certain challenges apart from that, the query response quality of service parameters also, how accurately I'm satisfying the particular query and the timeliness of the query and reliability of the query is a very important aspect. So all these network query processing, they need to really, while designing any kind of network query processing approaches, we need to really consider the resource constraints of the sensor network and its unreliable nature of the sensor network. And when we wanted to really process the queries, obviously another important aspect is, since we are aiming at optimizing the query with respect to the energy consumption, so we need to really focus on the amount of information which is going to be transmitted across the sensor network. That is a very important aspect. So how do we reduce the amount of data which is going to be communicated when we are processing the query? So that's where the data aggregation parameters or approaches are coming in play. So the data aggregation, what it does is, it is trying to integrate the copies received from multiple sensors and try to send the summarized copy or one copy to meet the user needs. Okay, so these data aggregation operators can be, they try to reduce the size of the data which is received, which are coming from multiple sensors. Sometimes they don't do anything in the production. Instead, they perform certain operations on the data and try to forward it. So data aggregation comes in two flavors, either with reduction or without size reduction also. Suppose if I say that when I wanted to find out the maximum temperature, I'm receiving the parameters from various sensors. So what I can do is, while sending it, even though I'm receiving the temperature values from four sensors, what I can do is, I'm going to select the maximum temperature and forward it to the next node, right? And so that is what with the size reduction. Sometimes we need to send all the parameters to the next node also. That is what we call it. We perform certain operations, but at the same time, we'll be sending and the data without any size reduction also. So there are two types of data aggregation is performed. Okay, and when we wanted to perform this data aggregation, obviously the node should have the local computing and storage capacity. That is very important. Okay. and generally, the performance of the data aggregation protocol is going to be closely related to the network topology. So theoretically, the data aggregation problem has been come under the NP-FAS problem. So they try to find out an optimal strategies by which data aggregation can happen. So the optimal strategy, it means that we need to find an optimal aggregation strategy which is going to consume less energy. That is what one of the important, considering the dynamically changing topologies of the network. Okay. See, we cannot aggregate too much. When we aggregate too much, the data quality is going to be, in response to the query, the data quality is going to be less, and latency is going to be reduced. That is what data quality, I said that it's in terms of accuracy. And certain models are focusing on periodic aggregation also. And periodic aggregation, it is only periodic data delivery model. Okay, it is not a snapshot aggregation. And periodically, every sensor node is going to really periodically update the global estimation of the environment and keeps on aggregating observations obtained by itself and from the neighboring nodes. Periodically, they are going to perform the aggregation. So when they do the periodic aggregation, obviously they need to decide that it is necessary to transfer the new estimation to the neighbors or not. That is one of the crucial aspects they need to focus upon. If a node receives an estimation from its neighbors, it will aggregate the received estimation with its own node and decide to transmit the new estimation to its neighbors and so on. That is how the information is going to be propagated up, right? So generally, when we perform any kind of a data aggregation, I mean, when we design any data aggregation approaches for wireless sensor networks, certain performance measures we need to consider. One is, we need to minimize the amount of transmission and the number of messages also, so that we can able to save the network lifetime. And latency, the delay should not be too much. The network latency needs to be, because in the name of processing the aggregation operation, we should not increase the delay in answering the query. That is another aspect. Third one is, too much aggregation also going to relate to the, going to affect the data accuracy aspect. So because, and as well as most of the sensor nodes are having high data loss rates and very noisy data is going to be generated. By performing the aggregation on this noisy data, it's further is going to affect the data accuracy also. So that is why all these factors are going to get affected, network lifetime, latency, and data accuracy, all are going to be affected by the network dynamic network topology, network density, and the location discovery mechanisms. This is a very important aspect. Whoever is going to design any data aggregation approaches, they need to consider these particular three important attributes while designing the data aggregation protocols. Right. There are various data aggregation protocols are in place. One is called the flooding. Flooding in the sense, you try to, whenever you wanted to aggregate data, obviously the node is going to start by flooding its data to all its neighbors. Okay, when any node gets two same copies of data, eventually they are going to perform certain kind of aggregations. This is going to have two important problems. One is implosion. and it's going to say overlap problem, because all the nodes are going to send the data to all the nodes, obviously. So the replicate, the amount of information is going to be there. And another one is two nodes are going to get the information from the same sensors. Again, that is going to be called as an overlapping problem. So the splitting is going to be considered as a very costly approach. That is why we are going for gaussing. Gaussing is also a kind of a splitting, but it tries to avoid implosion. But the idea for gaussing has been utilized over here. Okay, so instead of the nodes, they do not broadcast the packet. Instead, they're going to choose a random node, select the neighbor to really send the data. But still, the overlap still exists in this case. So that is another problem in gaussing. That is why most of the nodes, they don't go for either flooding and gaussing. Flooding incurs a huge amount of message overhead and redundant information at each node. And again, because of these two problems. And that is why people are dividing the network from flat network into hierarchical network. Okay, so by dividing the network into hierarchical network, obviously either the network can be formed in the form of a tree or a cluster or a chain or a grid and so on. So they try to place the nodes according to this particular. That is why these data aggregation protocols are called the structure-based protocols. So organize the nodes in any one of the form based on the predefined tree, predefined cluster formation, predefined chain formation, predefine the grid-based formation, arrange the nodes accordingly, then try to perform the aggregation operation. In case of tree-based approach, perform aggregation by constructing an aggregation tree. So the aggregation tree, generally, it will be a minimum spanning tree, rooted at the sink, and source nodes are considered as leaves. That's all. Each node has a parent node to forward its data. The tree is going to guide us how the aggregation operation is going to really happen, and who is going to perform the aggregation operation, who is going to send the data, and so on. As far as the cluster-based approach is also concerned, here also the whole network is going to be divided into a number of clusters. And each cluster has a cluster head, which is it can be selected by the cluster members, or maybe there are many means by which the cluster members can be selected. And the cluster head is going to play the role of an aggregator, okay? So whichever the data comes from the cluster members are going to be aggregated at this particular cluster head. In case of a chain-based approach, each sensor is going to transmit data only to its closest neighbor. So no overlapping principle, it is a chain chain of operations. Nodes are organized in a linear chain for the data aggregation. Even in case of grid-based approaches also, here what we are going to do, we are going to assign some kind of a regions, fixed regions. So that's where the data aggregators are going to be located. For each region, we are going to fix a data aggregator. So the sensor in a particular grid transmits the data directly to the aggregator of the grid. So these are the various popular approaches. Under each category, there are several aggregation protocols that are existing in the literature. You can perform a study on that. So these approaches are mainly concentrating on how these structures are going to be created, and based on what, how we are going to evaluate the structure's performance and so on. The third one is how we are going to really decide the aggregated node. These are the three important research issues that have been focused by the most of the aggregation protocols. Generally, the aggregated node selection can be random based on the energy consumption, based on the residual energy, based on the average minimum reachability power, based on the coverage area, and so on. There are various criteria that are used to select the aggregated node selection. So these are various popular algorithms considering these four categories. Right? All of you may be knowing about the Leech protocol, Pegasus, and the tag approach. Already discussed, they use a semantic routing tree to perform the routing of query and perform the aggregation operation too. All right? And apart from while doing the aggregation itself, some researchers are concentrating on how we can really perform the secure aggregation. Right. So as I said, that the sensor data is going to be very noisy. Okay. The noise is due to the noise can be explicit noise or it may be implicit noise also. The noise can be created with the help of intruder. Or the sensor environment may be noisy, that is why the sensed element is also going to be noisy. So we need to really decide that how do we design a suitable security mechanisms for wireless sensor network, considering the resource constraints of the wireless sensor network. Okay, so there are several attacks are possible on the sensor network routing. Okay, that is, all of you may be already familiar with what type of attacks are possible on wireless sensor network. These type of attacks are also possible in wireless sensor network, because whatever mobile attack networks are facing a problem, and the similar types of attacks are possible in case of wireless sensor networks too. There is SIGFOL, wormhole, hello flood alert, acknowledgement spoofing, and others. All these attacks are possible. So that is why we need to really take care of all these attacks, because the aggregator node simply should not receive the data and simply drop the information, keep passing the information from the members. So it should not happen that way. So we need to be careful about how exactly or securely we can able to perform the aggregation operation. Otherwise, it is going to really harm the lifetime of the total network. So while designing an aggregation protocol, we need to take into account of all these type of attacks too. Not only other two parameters, whatever we have discussed earlier, this parameter is another important parameter we need to really. Apart from that, as I said, that these attacks are maybe explicit or implicit, and whether due to intruder, we are getting a false information, and we need to have a way by which these false information can be detected also. So generally, to detect the false information, it's not a one-layer solution. That is why cross-layer solutions are required generally. They normally use the upper layers based cross-layer solutions in order to really detect whether the information is a false or whether it is induced into the network and so on. But as far as the wireless sensor network scenario is concerned, these detection mechanisms should be very lightweight. So that is because considering the resource constraint nature. So some researchers are focusing on how do we develop an lightweight secure mechanisms really to detect this false information, right? So apart from this query processing, and we can also perform data analysis on the wireless sensor network data. But generally, the data analysis cannot be performed on the sensor nodes, okay? Because we need to perform a sensor data analysis for various reasons. Suppose we wanted to find out better monitoring of a dynamic environment. For example, suppose we are interested in monitoring the soil conditions. Due to rain and other things, the sensor nodes may be replaced and so on. So in that case, we wanted to analyze where the sensor node, how the situation of the nodes, and all this kind of analysis can be performed in order to monitor the dynamic environments. And we may be acquiring a new knowledge from the unreachable dangerous locations, for example, in case of volcanic eruptions, early detection of tremors, all this can be found out from the sensitive data also. So by knowing these kind of things in early detection of these unwanted events, obviously we can issue warnings and as well as we can have an emergency evacuation mechanisms also. Okay, so we need to have a mechanism by which we can able to detect various type of anomalies, unexpected behavior patterns also from the sensitive data. So for this also we need to have a data, and we need to perform a data analysis of this data. Huge data needs to be really gathered at the sync node, and the analysis is going to be performed on the historical data. Right. Sometimes we will be extracting spatial and temporal correlations within the sensor node also, right? Suppose by which we can able to eliminate the redundant sensors, and we can localize the sensors at optimal locations and so on. So for these reasons, we need to perform a spatial and temporal correlations also. Okay, even wireless sensor networks are finally leading to IoT applications, cyber physical systems and so on. So obviously, if you consider the Internet of Things, the cyber physical systems, the inside element is nothing but a wireless sensor network with additional features are going to be there. So when you sense the data, obviously we can by using this particular data, we can able to make very intelligent decisions and autonomous controller and so on. All kind of things are possible. So the data analysis needs to be performed on the sensor elements. Okay, and another important aspect of wireless sensor network is the data is going to come in the form of streams and are in a continuous fashion. And it is going to come from a huge amount of sensors also. Sometimes it's going to be bulky. So whatever the data mining algorithms we are going to design, they should get really cater the needs of this data streaming nature of the data sensor sensitive data. That is very important. And certain times we need to really design an online data mining algorithm so that the response of the going to be quick and the predictions can be made. So that is a very important. Online data mining algorithms are very crucial aspects because we need to take decisions immediately, right? So that is what. Generally, these data mining algorithms are generally classified either centralized or distributed processing, but at present, most of the analysis are performed at the sensor node. So that's all from my side as far as data management aspects are concerned. Most of the issues are taken care. Okay. So to conclude, I can say that we need to really, suppose in case we are using multiple sync nodes, we need to have a mechanism by which the synchronization among the sync nodes are possible. We need to take care of the data redundancy issues by which the network lifetime can be really increased. Sending issues at the sensor nodes is a very important aspect. We need to have some kind of a processing capability by which we can able to decide the amount of data which is going to be sent from the sensor nodes can be decided. So as far as possible, we'll try to reduce the communication overhead in processing the data. Okay, and when even processing the data, the security aspects also needs to be focused on. So if you have any queries, I keep some time for the participants' queries. If you have any queries, then please.
Thank you, madam. So we have one question in the chat box. So how can we mitigate the sinkhole attack in WSN? That was one question from Dr. Shankar. Hello.
Madam, could you able to hear us, madam?
Hello.
Sorry. Yeah, madam. There was one question which I could see in the chat box from one Mr. Dr. Shankar P.
What is the question?
How can we mitigate the sinkhole attack in WSN?
Yeah. Sinkhole attack is a behavior-based attack, actually, basically. We need to monitor the sensor node. Maybe which node is going to be monitored, that is important. Whether the aggregator node is going to act as a sink node, then we need to have a behavior-based approaches are going to be normally used to mitigate the sinkhole attacks. We need to monitor the behavior over a period of time.
I could see only one question in the chat box. If anybody else having any questions regarding the session, they can just type it in the chat box, or they can unmute yourself and just speak. Anybody having any doubts regarding the
audience can unmute and you can ask your question if needed.
That's a fine. No problem.
Madam, we can conclude. Thank you so much. I think you are having some kind of difficulty, and even then you had a very good 1.5 hours of complete session. So we thank you, madam.
Thank you.
And Uni Krishna, yeah, you can proceed. Yeah.
Yeah, madam was about to say something.
Thank you all of you, take care.
So thank you once again, ma'am, on behalf of all of us here at PlyTK and participants. I would extend my sincere gratitude to Professor P. Shanti Tilagam for the wonderful session on WSNs and data analysis and data management part of it. It was a wonderful session, and I am very sure that all the participants have benefited with respect to the sensor data analytics part. So our we are so we are closing in now with a break till 12 noon. So our next session, that is session 8, will be there, will be starting at 12 o'clock. So we are breaking here now. So all of you participants, please find the link for the attendance for the session 7 in the chat box. Please, please do it as soon as possible, so that we'll be close. We'll be closing that form soon after this session. Okay. So thank you all.
Yeah, I'll leave the session. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, madam. Yeah.
Okay, so we are closing in for this break. Please let us join back at 12. Okay. Thank you. Thank you.